It's strange. Code is part of our everyday lives, yet some myths and misconceptions are hard to dispel. Do you want to learn to code? Do you want to work with programmers? Do you want to understand how they think? If any of these are true, these common myths and misconceptions will hinder you. Let's take a look together. One common assumption is that every problem has a logical solution. The same sentiment underlies the question, will AI ever replace software developers? I often hear this expressed as programming is just variables and loops and conditions. But you might as well say that writing is just stringing letters together, or that composing music is just about choosing the right sequence of notes. To illustrate, let's look at what might seem to be a very simple problem. We have a list of numbers and we want to sort them from smallest to biggest. Surely there must be a logical solution here. How would you go about it? Take 2 seconds to think. First, you can go through all the numbers to find the biggest one and then repeat the process on the remaining numbers. But you can also go through the list from start to finish and compare two adjacent entries, two by two, swap them every time you find two that are in the wrong order, and then repeat the process until there's nothing left to sort. A third way of sorting is to start by selecting one entry in the list, then sort the numbers relative to that number into two segments, the numbers that are bigger and the numbers that are smaller. Then repeat the process on every subsegment, and then again. I could keep going here, as there are 21 more algorithms listed on Wikipedia, and that's just those that have acceptable levels of performance. But which of these is the best one? Well, I've got bad news. There is no one best one. It depends on how sorted we think the list might be, on how big the list is, on how much it costs to read data and to write it, and on so much more. Each of these algorithms has advantages and costs. There is no one best solution. And do you know what? It gets worse. There's a class of problems called NP problems, which stands for non-deterministic polynomial. These problems don't have any known algorithm that can solve them in a reasonable amount of time. The myth of the logical solution is dangerous. Logic is important, clearly, but it's far from the only factor to consider. Instead, as software engineers, we need to find creative solutions and craft the best possible fit for a given problem. And to do that, we first need to understand the problem. Which brings me to my next question. What do you think a software engineer's most important tool is? Is it a computer? Is it the code editor? Is it pen and paper? Is it our ears and mouths? Coding isn't the only task software engineers perform. It isn't even the most important task of software development. We first need to use our mouths and our ears, then pen and paper, and then only then the code editor. Why? Before starting to program, developers must first understand the problem or the need. That requires communicating with stakeholders to understand their needs, their expectations. A software engineer must be able to ask the right questions and understand the answers. Otherwise, we risk wasting our time working on something no one wants, and that is the reason why I'm not worried about AI taking our jobs, because the hardest part of designing a feature isn't writing the code, it's gaining a deep understanding of the user's needs. The second step is to design a solution. It's tempting to dive in, but first we need to map the course. We need to think about everything that could go wrong, about how the change will impact other users and other systems, about things like performance and cost and best practices and risks and maintainability and legal constraints. Software design is translating requirements into software architecture. This is best done with pen and paper, not a keyboard, and requires creativity and problem-solving skills. Once we've collected the needs and designed the system, then we can begin typing source code. But not only for the feature, we also write tests to detect failures automatically. This ensures the code is maintainable. Ideally, we even start with a test before even coding the feature. And once the software has been coded and tested, the product is released. But that's just the very beginning of the story. Now comes maintenance, an important part of which is hunting and squishing bugs. And there's no such thing as a simple bug. Stupid mistakes like simple typos can take a week to find and to fix. Bug solving often requires deep analytical thinking and problem solving. It's about deconstructing the logic and understanding where it has gone wrong. Software engineering is a complex and multifaceted discipline. It requires communication skills, creativity, problem solving, attention to detail, and analytical skills. People often believe the difficulty with programming is mastering the syntax of the language. It isn't. The difficulty is abstract thinking and modeling the problem. Coding is just one piece of a larger puzzle. A software engineer must be able to work with users and understand their needs. They must be able to design software systems and then write code, test it, and maintain it. And maintenance may well be the one task we all underestimate. Why? Well, there's a saying, the code you wrote 6 months ago may just as well have been written by someone else. Allow me to explain. Imagine, we need to make a change, and we need to make it fast. What do we do? Well, we have a choice. Do we take the time to think about the impact? Do we test the result? Do we spend the time to get someone else to proofread the code? Or do we rush the change and push it to production? If I must be honest, I've often taken the second route. Sometimes you have to move fast. That's fine. But I've always paid the price. In real life, cheating can cause you trouble. But in software engineering, shortcuts always have consequences. There's always a cost to pay. In programming, karma isn't just a belief, it's a fact of life. Why? Well, allow me to explain. If programming is about one thing, it's about consequences. If this, then that, remember. It's about building a complex system with intricate logical rules, and no human mind can hold the precise details of every single system's behavior, nor of every functionality's logic. When we cheat and we go the quick and dirty route instead of slow and steady one, we create cognitive dissonance. We create mental friction. We make our code harder to understand. We create a future cost for ourselves. That future cost has a name. We call it technical debt. It means we've cut corners, but we'll need to spend more time in the future making things clean. And that's where the problem I alluded to earlier kicks in. I can't tell you the number of times I've looked at a piece of code and said, "Who's the complete moron who wrote this?" and then realized it was me when I was trying to be clever or fast. What can we learn from these three myths? There's this thing called the Dunning-Kruger effect. It's a weird cognitive bias. People overestimate their competence when it is low and underestimate when it's high. To phrase things differently, a little knowledge is a dangerous thing. Conversely, when you do become competent, you start doubting your abilities because you're aware of how much of the road lies ahead. You're aware of how much you don't know. You realize there is still so much more to learn. And that, my friends, is the journey ahead of us. And if you want to keep learning with me, well, join me in the next video.